Good afternoon and welcome to Dun & Bradstreet webinar on Beyond the Pandemic, the Next Normal for MSME. Today, our session will be starting with a presentation by Dr. Arun Singh, Global Chief Economist, Dun & Bradstreet, covering what could be the next normal look like for the MSMEs. This would be followed by a Q&A session between Dr. Singh and Mr. Thiru R, COO, Kinara Capital. The Q&A will focus on what are the steps MSMEs should take to generate better credits. Please allow me to introduce our speakers. Dr. Arun Singh, Global Chief Economist, Dun & Bradstreet, has worked across global quantitative and qualitative economic research, econometric modeling, and commodity and industry research for the last two decades. He has provided strategic advice and expertise to aid decision-making within various government and private organizations. Dr. Singh's ability to connect economic insight and data and explain business implication has led to him becoming a trusted advisor and expert for media, government, and clients alike. Mr. Thiru R, COO, Kinara Capital. Thiru is the CEO of Kinara Capital, a Bangalore-based NBFC founded in 2011, known for his disrupted lending in India by providing loans without property collaterals to small business, thus building financial inclusion for entrepreneurs who drive economic growth. Kinara Capital has disbursed over 1,700 crores across 35,000 loans to small businesses that had directly led to the creation of 65,000 new jobs, including for first-time earners and women. Thiru oversees the day-to-day field operation of a vast network of regional offices and hubs of Kinara Capital and is also the first point of contact for their customers. Thiru has been with Kinara Capital for its early days and hand-delivered the loan disbursement to Kinara's first customers. He has been actively involved in the Indian microfinance sector for two decades, starting his career with Dhan Foundation, where he initiated and managed the microfinance program in a rural block in Tamil Nadu state. Before we start today, some ground rules. Your lines are muted throughout the webinar. There will be a Q&A session after the two sessions. You're requested to please ask your question in the Q&A tab available in your screen. Please do mention your name and organization name when you're asking this question. Over to Dr. Arun Singh.
Thank you, Noena, and welcome all to this webinar. And you know, as Noena was trying to mention that this is unprecedented time, and this time is really not good. No one expected that what's happening to the economy today. We never thought of even in the month of March when the first lockdown announcement came. Everyone thought that it's just 21 days and you know things will come to the normal, and every day we had some hope that we'll go back to the normal. And then eventually today we all know that tomorrow when we talk about the normal, that's normal is not the same normal what we have seen before the lockdown announcement, or what we have seen in the month of March and what we have seen in the month of February. That normal, what we are calling is the next normal, is basically completely different direction. And many people use the new normal, many people use the next normal, but that idea is that that's not going to be the same era what we have seen during the pre-pandemic era. For many sectors, that could be the reality, that they have to live with the new normal, they have to live with the next normal platform. For some of them, a very handful of them, that the new normal will be like what they were in the pre-pandemic era. Many sectors, of course, they've changed currently. In fact, that's good for them, but that they will go back when they started in month of let's say March. So moving on, and trying to have a perspective on the what the beyond pandemic look like and what the next normal for MSME space look like, because the large company somehow they will try to manage their businesses in the next normal, and they have a list of the people who are supporting them. But it's very critical, very important for MSME to understand that how that new economy will look like, so as they can plan their approach and they can plan entire business process around that. And that's basically the idea of this webinar today. And let's see how we can take this ahead. Now, moving on, if you see, what do you call new normal, when you talk about, there are basically four factors which will shape the new normal behavior or new normal thinking and new normal approach for all of us. The COVID-19 pandemic it's the greatest human tragedy. It's also a big loss and big shock to the economy, and that we all are basically victim of that. We all are have seen or experienced that the shock, and that's basically how the shock is going to change that behavior. There's four factors. One, the reduced income levels. The second, rise in uncertainty. Basically, reduced income level will certainly create that rise in uncertainty. The social distancing is the third factors which we should be worried about, and then fourth is basically the resilience gap. Now, when we go back, to the normal, that normal, as I say, that's not going to be the same normal what we have seen prior to March lockdown. That normal is basically is a new normal. That normal is basically the next normal. If we don't do that, then certainly we are categorize ourselves as winner, and suppose we don't do that, certainly we are risking shrinking. Basically, that's one concern. So then let's understand that how each four factors are basically going to shape that new normal, and why I'm saying that these four factors, I think we should be cognizant of that. Now let's take a first factor, that's reduced income levels. From economy perspective, if you talk about overall broad economy, there's only one parameter when we look at, that's basically GDP growth. Or the from income side, we look at the per capita income growth. And the GDP growth rate, if you talk about, we are back to FY18 years. In FY18, the per capita income of this economy was something around 1 lakh rupees. And FY19, FY20, and prior to prior to lockdown announcement, we were gradually growing up. So the initial forecast of the per capita GDP was something around 1,30,000 for this year. Unfortunately, now that went to 1 lakh back. Actually, it's exactly the same what it was in FY18, which means we are pushed back by 3 years. Our progress of the growth, our progress in terms of the income, now back to 3 years back in FY18, which means if you don't do some radical changes in our own income generation, our own income behavior, which means we are going to have a serious repercussion on our businesses and on economy. But because that's what it's indicating, that we are almost 3 years back. The right hand side of the chart, if you look at, is basically a digital survey done on the consumer or the customer, basically how they feel that COVID-19 is going to impact their personal or household finances. This is India specific. This survey is basically worldwide specific, we pulled just for India specific. You can see that something around 65% of people said that there's a dramatic or big impact. When I say dramatic or big impact, that everything has fallen on the earth basically, and that's a serious concern. Now, when we talk about why they're saying that the household finance or personal finance have collapsed, because there are three set of people, and a three set of impact happened. One, the people have lost their job. The second, people have not lost their job, but they have a reduced income. Maybe they have a 50% reduction in the salary, 50% reduction in the income. And the third set of categories who basically lost their livelihood. Maybe, you know, we're talking about some of the migrant workers. We're talking about some of the people who basically lost the job in the white collar space. And all this is going to contribute to the lower economy income or lower growth in the economy. Now moving into the other slide. Yeah, now let's talk about uncertainty. That's basically the next factor which is going to shape the new normal. Look at this rise in uncertainty. This is the basically index captured by global organization on a parameter that how uncertainty is being taken seriously at this point of time. And today, during coronavirus 2019 outbreak in 2020 year, this all-time high. In fact, that's four times higher than the uncertainty was created during SARS 2002-2003 pandemic era. It's a four times bigger, and this is just the uncertainty. And that uncertainty, if you map to the global expectation, that how they feel that in fact, when they feel that recovery will come back to the normal or economy will come back to the normal, if you see, there are 60-70% of the people saying that the recovery will start from March 2021 onward, which means either up to 1 year or more than 1 year. The 70% of the respondents are saying that, and which means they feel, because the ground reality is that, and that's how that's how the repercussion looking like from a COVID perspective. And that's a perception, and the perception sometimes on the ground reality is a leading indicator for the economic behavior, which means we cannot sit idle for next 1 year doing nothing. And basically we have to, the idea of that is that we have to accept the next normal, we have to accept the new normal and move on. The third factor for today is the social distancing. Look at this. This is the Global Mobility Index. And then the first day and the first week of the lockdown announcement, if you see, the mobility index of the household, that's residential, gone up. It's like 126%, which means most of the people are back home. So 100% is prior to pandemic era, And look at that. Then in other area, the grocery, the workplace, the transit station, the parks, retail and recreations, all dropped significantly. Some of them is like as low as the 25%. That's 22%. We have some of the sectoral information that the most of the sectors, the workplace was hardly 22%, which means just 22% of the employee went to the company in those sectors. So that was a concern from that. So you can see the people are basically working from the home. Now, what it mean for us? Now, the social distancing measures have changed our daily routines, as well as the way in which the businesses are conducted. Clearly, more people are staying indoors, and they doesn't want to go out or even for the shopping, recreations or other workplace requirement, which means as a company, we need to reach out to their doors rather than they are coming to us, which means we have to, irrespective of what what business we are, whether we're in a B2B, B2G, or B2C. The consideration is now C. The consideration is a consumer, because that will decide what new set of product look like. And that's basically the need of the app for all of us to take it ahead. Now, moving on the fourth, the factor is going to shape the new normal or the next normal is the resilience gap. Resilience gap. What do you mean by resilience gap? In a normal time, we take a many decisions, and we decide that we basically will implement some of those decisions and implement some of those calls. What's happening? The resilience gaps are created. Basically, we fail to take a call. We fail to follow some of the decisions through implementation during the good time. For example, in the manufacturing space, we talks about the alternate material. We talks about the high level of manufacturing mechanism, high level of manufacturing machineries, or adopting the digital age, or adopting to a new normal and what's happening in the marketplace. Sometimes we fail. For example, the Digital India initiatives started by the government at a massive level for quite some time. But what's happening today that most of the people have struggled, or most of people have delayed that going digital for quite some time. And that's basically resilience gaps created, and that's disrupted the supply chain. Over two-fifths of the companies, and what we surveyed, they said this pandemic had hit their supply chain very hard, and as a result of that, average lead time is almost two times than what it used to be earlier. That's a repercussion. Just 21% of this company, they said they have a highly resilient network at this point of time, which means they're impacted, but they will go back and try to work around to find a solution that their supply chain are restored, which means 79% of the company have no fallback option, have no mechanism to restore the supply chain. That's basically resilience gap, because we are victim of our own call, which we have not taken on time. Now look at the other piece which we have basically work around the area. We reach out to the organization like you in terms of trying to understand in order to understand how bad you feel from impact size. If you see, that's the same thing around 10, 9, 8 rating. That's a very high impact, a high negative impact. It's around something around 40% at this point of time. 45% of things so seriously impacting a supply side chain, which means we have not taken call in the past, and now we are suffering. That needs to change, which means we have to take a call, and the call has to be so prompt, and so as the next behavior should be in a positive manner to impact your business in the positive way, not holding back some of the decisions not to implement, because this resilience gap is all about that. Now that's basically four subject area of I thought I'll touch base what it mean by that. Now how the new next normal look like, where are these basically next normal area or concentration of area, and basically the ask from all of us to engage time and energy and money to basically leverage what the opportunity we are going, and to try to navigate ourselves during the next normal era. The four shift we can see. The one is basically we are going to be digital. It's a more digital, basically. That's what I basically was talking about, and that's adoption of the digital technology needs to be all time high. The second thing is that the consumer of tomorrow will not be the same as today's. What he spends and how he spends will be undergone significant change. That's what basically called the altered consumer behavior. So the consumer is not the same consumer going to be in the future, the different consumer. The third point is decentralization of the supply chain. When I say decentralization of the supply chain is basically is one term, but the one term will have a many area, many focus around that, where they talk about where are your vendor based, is this overseas, which sector they are operating, which sector you are operating, whether the sector is going to be impacted by any of this type of pandemic or any changes. So the supply chain decentralization is just one term, but that will have a many angle to that. And then increased focus on the resilience. When I say increased focus on the resilience, so the same thing, I think. Now we need to be very prompt and taking a call very pragmatic way or promptly, basically. We cannot delay in terms of making a decisions or taking a call. Now, what do you mean by more digital? In a typical world, if you talk about the digital adoption is basically championed by only one stakeholder, either the consumer or businesses or the government, and the rest of the people follow. But this pandemic has changed completely, and that's a digital transformation across all the spectrum is happening. For example, if you take a government, they are using a new set of platform, a real-time platform to update what's happening in the COVID-19 and the contact tracing. And that's basically they're using that. Many apps, they have Setu app, for example, Arogya Setu app. That's the new thinking, and that people are adopting to that. And that's in the heads of to the overall initiative that look at the people are, taking the part in that, and that's the heads up to the government. They have started this one. That's what's changing, and some of these changes are here to stay. And these are the digital transformation. It will not go back to the pre-pandemic era. This is going to stay here. Now, from here, the people will basically build more case to take that ahead. Now, the consumers are not going physically to buy stuff. They are on the online shopping. Online shopping was there, but the penetration of the online shopping was not that great. But today, online shopping is basically going up. The businesses have enabled the remote working capacities for their employees. Sales have become more virtual rather than the physical. And some of these changes are going to stay here. It's not going to go back the pre-pandemic era. And that's basically things which we should be mindful of that. Now looking at the altered consumer behavior at this point of time. Now, altered consumer behavior, which basically I was talking about earlier, these are the mobile app downloads ranked, by the, it's a global organizations here. What consumers are looking at this point of time today, these are the basically apps download by consumer. One, look at the businesses and education. That's a multiply. The people are basically talking about how businesses are done at home or through digital platform or through different methods and different protocol following the digital mechanism. Look at that app download. It's a multiply. It's a very high, it's around 126%, 130% roughly, which means they used to do 100. Today, they are doing 230. Look at the jump. Similar case for the education. That's basically e-education apps. They used to do 100. Now they are doing 190. That's basically how we can look at. And there are many apps consumers are looking at. It's news, social networking, books, medical, entertainment, and games, stuff like that. And these download are categorized into multiplied, very strong, moderate, and struggling. Look at the sectors, they're basically struggling. No interest in the navigation tools, no interest in the sports, no interest in the travels. In fact, that's a decline, including the finance. And that's a problem. At this point of time, there's a troubled working capital, there's a troubled behavior about various stuff. And that's basically it has changed overall approach toward the towards the next normal what we look at this point of time. And that's a serious concern. That's a serious concern one can see from that side. Now moving on to the altered consumer behavior from a sectoral side, if you look at these are the basically let's look at these this platform, these apps from a sector perspective, from a business's perspective. Two axes we have. One, the likelihood of that changes going to go up in the future. That's basically the horizontal axis, and growth during the COVID-19 era. Basically, it's a temporary shift today. And we have basically categorized into 2x2 matrix. That's the four blocks at this point of time. The one block, what you call the temporary shift. Temporary shift means it's grown today. It's gone up very high. For example, e-education, telemedicine. But in going forward, that's not going to stay. In India, the e-education still not success, is not going to continue, because that people will go back to the school, people will go back to the college, people will go back to physical education rather than online. Online will have some traction, but the physical education will again be restored. Today in India, telemedicine is basically not what the people prefer. It's basically it's the need of the hour, and that's what people are doing that. It's not going to continue in the future, which means there's a temporary shift. It's just for today, and that will stay for some time. The right-hand side of the chart, that's a green if you see, that's an accelerated shift, which means a shift. It's basically the shift happened, a very rampant shift. For example, do it yourself, product type, digital payment, e-finance, online shopping, self-cooking, social networking, video streaming, all basically have seen the many traction. That traction is going to stay even in the future. That's what I'm saying, is the accelerated shift. These are the sectors that I basically have to see that more and more revenue flowing into that stream, and that's basically a good part for them. Contenders has basically have not seen that success story. Let's say cosmetic, e-books, e-coupons, grocery delicacies, online games, station, video conferencing, because businesses are doing. Now, more and more company will create that virtual platform for their employees, businesses to do businesses from a home, business from in anywhere places. That's the stuff. And then there are sectors what we call as strugglers. They have not grown today, and they're not going to be growing, or maybe the growth will not be the incremental. That's the same thing. Let's say basically dining and food delivery and the ride sharing. Basically, these are going to stay the same what they used to be and what they basically today. There's no growth mechanism looking at. So basically the idea of this chart is to just showcase that some of the sectors have grown tremendously at this point of time, and some of the sectors will go back to the normal, will not grow, and some of the sector will continue that growth journey and will basically enter in the next normal or new normal phase. That's basically the focus area of that block, is basically the accelerator shift, that green block where basically we have to find our place, and that's the area the sectors are looking good. Now, the fourth part, the supply chain deceleration and the increased focus on resilience, that basically the second and the third part. Now the supply chain, decentralization, which I was just talking about, is basically this pandemic redefining the supply chain in three different ways, with increased focus on the resilience. Now the first, the supply chain will basically get more focus on the decentralized in the short term. Both domestic as well as international buyer, we look for the alternate suppliers with increased focus on the reliability. in the long term, the trend of the nearshoring will gather the momentum. Basically, now the credibility of your vendor is going to be very critical at this point of time. You need to establish the credibility of your vendor. Your credibility vendor, either in India or outside India, has to be established. Which country they are looking at, basically the country profile is very critical. Which sector they are looking at, or which sector they belongs to, that is going to be very critical. And what they are doing financially is going to be critical. Basically, the credibility and reliability of that vendor is very critical. The second is basically how you bring them into nearshore, or maybe close to you, or maybe the same area, same district, or same country. The second element is basically rebalancing your inventory management. That's a very critical part, because the pandemic has revealed the weaknesses of just-in-time production models. I mean, because we are victim of that. We basically, when I say victim, actually we are culprit from that side. We are basically just-in-time production facilitator sort of things, and that's basically most of the company do that, and that's very that's very problematic for things to take it ahead. Business will take a more balanced approach between just-in-time production and stockpiling. That we need to be very careful. And the third element which you have to basically looking at is basically revamping your business model. The fleet optimization will have a very, very increased focus in a near term, or maybe the next normal, which means each company has to have a good tie-up with a logistic company provider, because they're your optimization, your supply chain, your vendor management, and your inventory has to be in a sync, so as you are feeling confident in terms of delivering to your customer. That's which means you have to have a strategic tie-up with some of the logistics sector provider. Now, these are the things basically what we spoke about from a company perspective, and from what each MSME should be doing in the next normal, and how things one can take forward. But from an economy side, if you look at, there's very specific things which new pandemic or this pandemic have thrown to us, and I think we should be looking for the next normal stuff. This is basically the cost of the manufacturing, and then your own market size, and this is basically again 2x2 matrix, where the vertical axis is basically manufacturing cost of producing goods within the country, and horizontal axis is the manufacturing cost, and the vertical axis is basically talking about your own economic size in terms of the PPP and what the demand you offer. Look at the India. India is the left top bottom, which means we are low in terms of manufacturing cost index, and we are very high in terms of demand. Today, what's happening that we found many companies are operating from China, and that's what they're doing that. In tomorrow's world, in the next normal world, most of the global companies will now look with the low cost manufacturing destination like India, with their own domestic market size. India is basically one of that market who basically placed well in terms of attracting these global houses. And what we need to do, that growth story need to be communicated to these global houses, global companies, that hey, we are better off, we are better placed, and I think we should be able to work together to ensure that India becomes a good manufacturing hub. Now, journey started with the Make in India initiative. Now the pandemic is likely to give a more boost to that call, because most of global companies thinking in the same way to change their supply chain behavior, supply chain, or maybe the relocation in terms of where they're producing and where they're consuming. In that, India as a country holds very good opportunity, and I think we should be trying to capture that piece as a company. Now, from a sector side, in India, I was talking about overall economic advantage. Now, in the sector, these are the six sectors: the textiles, chemicals, metals, machineries, automotive, and electronics. In India, the Indian companies have a revealed comparative advantage, which means we are more competitive than anywhere in the world to produce goods within these sectors. The need of the hour, how to leverage the presence in these sectors so as we are better placed. We are better placed in terms of the sector, we are better placed in terms of the economy, and we are better placed in terms of our own company balance sheet, that we are pragmatically taking call to implement some of the decisions, and we know what's happening in overall COVID-19 perspective and how we are prepared for the next normal. So basically that was the economic opportunity one can leverage. How the sector impact look like? So in DNB, next normal is what basically everyone should eye for, but they should also look at which sector they are operating and what is the impact they are feeling. So basically overall sectoral impact and divided into two categories: one, the positive impact, one is the negative impact. Within negative impact, we will also judge in terms of the severity of that impact. Is it severe, high, moderate? I mean, you are impacted, but not severe. Okay, fine, good. And some of the other stuff, for example, positive impact category, let's say pandemic have really shown some opportunity for them. Let's say remote working applications, over the top media services, telecommunications, online gaming, e-education. All the sector I've just shown in the previous slide, that actually they have good, they are positively impacted and they should leverage on that. Rest of the sectors talk about the food, drugs, IT, ITS, MSMEs as a segment, aviation, livestock, metals, textiles, power, electronics, all basically are basically the badly impacted, badly impacted, and in terms of the severity they have seen. That's a basically area one should look that which sector they belongs to and what they're basically doing. Now, the final slide, maybe the final two slide is that's the impact. That's the impact slide we have seen. What is the recovery look like? When it's a recovery, you're talking about from today onward, when the unlock thing started, that's the first day of August. The 6 month is a short term, 7 to 12 month, the medium term, and long term is basically more than a year. From that, these are the sector mapping happening, that some of the sectors, for example, gems and jewelry, aviation, hospitality, they will take a more than a year to recover, which means forget about 2020, even the 2021 will not be a good for them, which means the player belongs to that sector needs to adapt to the next normal and move on. Now, the final slide before I conclude is basically, these are the sectoral behavior we have seen is going to change. For example, hotels have turned into the quarantine centers. The food chains, theaters, etc., have entered into the talent sharing agreement to redeploy their staff in sectors that are facing high demand. Automotive and textile companies are manufacturing ventilators and the face masks. You know, breweries and perfume makers are manufacturing hand sanitizers and disinfectants. Restaurant food delivery are basically tying up with the cab aggregators and started the grocery deliveries on, online delivery, basically. I'm saying that the company have started to leverage on their own strength to have a tie-up with the new set of the service provider to reach out to the consumer in the next normal phase. And that next normal phase is going to be permanent for many sectors, is going to be temporary for few sectors, and going to be basically vanished for many sectors if people are not basically taking that next normal seriously. With that note, I will conclude my presentation, and then we'll move to the next agenda item for today's presentation. Thank you.
May I please request Mr. Thiru to introduce himself and talk a little bit about, to set the context about Kinara Capital and what Kinara Capital does, and then we start the Q&A between you and Dr. Singh.
Yeah,
thank you. Thank you, Naina, and thank you, Dr. Arun. Hi, everyone. This is Thiru from Kinara Capital. So Kinara Capital is a fintech with a mission of financial inclusion. We do mostly digital processes with a personalized human touch, so that we enable the financial inclusion in an innovative manner. We provide collateral-free loans to small businesses in the range of 2 to 25 lakhs. As Naina was mentioning, we are spread across six states with 110 branches, and we have disbursed almost 1,750 crores as on date. Thank you again, Dr. Arun. It was a very good presentation. I agree with you. The one slide which talked about, despite the so many challenges because of this COVID-19, looking at the future, India has got a unique opportunity to grow because we have a diverse manufacturing and a supply chain, and the demand market is so good, as you are mentioning. And this is where I feel like the small businesses can actually lead the change post-COVID. As you all know, MSMEs are very key to our economic activity and also for the economic recovery going forward. And because this MSME sector is a sector, it's actually a manufacturing and production sector, but also it's a job creating sector. And it contributes very hugely for our India's GDP. So, similar to this kind of data points, we at Kinara Capital also conducted a small survey, extensive small survey in the sense with all our customers. I don't have a presentation to share, but I can definitely share some of the inferences so that from there we can get into the Q&A. The thing is, what we have seen is after the March lockdown, where most of the businesses had to kind of temporarily stop the production and the working. And the recent survey which we conducted last month, what we have seen is around 80% of these MSMEs have restarted their operation, which is a good thing. And the thing is, most of them, actually 75% of them are feeling that their businesses have come down at least 25 to 50% of their pre-COVID monthly revenues. So that is one thing, but also they feel that they might bounce back to the normal pre-COVID situation in the next 6 to 8 months. So that's the kind of positive signs which are showing. And the main challenges what we also see from an MSME perspective is the raw material supply got kind of slowed down because of the transportation issues, the labor, the people migrated from different cities, particularly from the metro cities. That is one of the challenges. They couldn't get the manpower, and also some of the payment delay from their buyers. So these are all the key challenges which they are currently undergoing. We at Kinara are kind of trying to support them by providing some kind of smaller loans and all. So this is kind of in short about Kinara. Maybe I will hand it over to back to Dr. Arun, and then we can take the Q&A process.
Thank you, thank you, Mr. Thiru. You know, that was really great insight, and what you feel in the market is really true. And you know, I think you are basically dealing with MSMEs, you know, at a ground level, and you basically aware of actually the problem faced by them on the ground. And you know, as I just said, that the first thing it hit during the pandemic or during any of the crises is basically the finance. And finance, when I say, and when finance, right, it comes to the MSME space, of course. You are in the good place to see what are the challenges these guys are saying. And in that context, there are, I thought I will have there are some couple of questions. I feel it will be good to understand that from MSME side, and this will be very good. So one thing I was just trying to understand that today what's happening, that forget about pandemic, is even the normal time, the MSME face a struggle in terms of getting finances or reaching out to an optimal level of financing for their most of the things. So today or maybe the post COVID time, so let's say, for example, next 2 months, 3 months, 4 months or 1 year, things open after that, how you see, what could be, or what are the parameters that MSME sector as a whole should focus or manage or work around to get the better credit terms with the with the financiers, with the companies who basically financing the MSME. What could be basically the parameter they should be focused on? I mean, can you please let everyone know about that?
Yeah, sure. See, what I would say is, I mean, that's a very important question, actually, because as you said, after the pandemic hit, most of the banks and NBFCs had slowed down their disbursements, but gradually it has been increased thanks to some support from the government schemes. Also, people are able to get some credit guarantee schemes through which we are able to give some loans also. But having said that, to particularly to answer your question, that in my view, I would say that they should focus on two D's, considering the current situation, which is, in my view, it should be diversify and digitize, or maybe I should say digitize and diversify, because nowadays the thing is, and particularly from a Kinara perspective, when we are giving collateral free loans, we are more focused on that to see more data around their revenues, cash flows, basically in their accounting. So I would actually advise the MSMEs to do more of a digital transactions. For example, starting from registering in say Udyog Aadhar or the Udyam Aadhar website, digitize all the business documents, do more banking transactions, do more of a GST transactions, so that the one another thing in your presentation you showed about the social distancing, which is going to be the new normal. So we as a company also, we have a very good strong field force, but we also want the people to travel less, but also not reduce the productivity. So what we want the customers to be more digital, so that we can disburse through more a digital way rather than doing all the doorstep services. But so that is one thing. That would be a good thing from and actually in our survey also we saw that customers are becoming more smarter. They are actually ready to do more digital thing. So that's a very good sign. I think that's the one thing we should more focus on. And second thing, as I said, the second D is about diversification or diversify. What we have seen is people are trying to be a little more flexible in their approaches. They have a CNC machine or a VMC machine, but they know during different timings, different kind of situation, what are the different products they can innovate or how can they adapt to this different situation. So some of our customers have started manufacturing COVID-related products, whether it could be masks or gloves or PPEs, whatever. So those are all the, they are not dependent on one single product. So diversification actually helps, because this COVID is really a big impact. But having seen that in the last two decades in this industry, what we have seen is also, in particular in the last 10 years, we have seen the demonetization had a smaller impact with the businesses. And then there was GST, which had some impact. In the last year, this auto sales zone had an impact, and now the COVID has become, forget about all the other natural calamities, everything. So this kind of impact keeps on happening. So how a customer will be more adaptable to the situation is also very important. So in my view, just to summarize, two Ds, I think digitize and diversify, that should be the focus for the MSMEs going forward.
No, I think that's important, and thanks Thiru for that. And you know exactly the point I was saying, that when the Digital India initiative started, the traction was while the government push was very very hard, but the traction was not that great, and that we have struggled to do that, and that's basically resilience gap. I was talking about, because now this is a time, I mean, we cannot basically afford from any of the company perspective to delay our decision making from a digital side, and exactly what basically you mentioned. So from that, there's one there's a that leading to the another question. So this development, have you seen any sectoral changes or any sectoral trend basically within the MSME space, or did you observe anything, or you think the sectoral changes will be different in the next normal. What basically I was trying to talk about from a finance perspective and from a need perspective, and then basically how what basically sectorally you can see help MSME, that you know there are sectors, high impact sector, there are low impact sector, in fact there are positive impact sector. Is there any trend observation you have, or any customized guidance you think you have for them?
What we have seen from a sectoral trend perspective, particularly in MSME with related to Kinara's portfolio also, is that overall what we have seen is the traders are actually kind of placed in a better situation compared to a manufacturer in terms of repayments, in terms of business continuity, in terms of dependency on the external factors, everything. Traders are actually placed better. They are performing better. And particularly the small retailers like the kirana shops and kind of people are performing good. The sectors which are dependent on agri and food and beverages are actually performing good, in the sense that their business is not that much and impacted. Manufacturing on the other side has obviously, because of this lockdown, because of the high dependency on the intensive labor dependency, manpower dependency, and also dependency on the transportation, all this has been kind of had an impact on the manufacturers. And because of that, there are less orders that has been, and as I said, there are some kind of payment delays, which is causing a working capital kind of an issue with the manufacturers. And I think that is also, as I said, it will come back to kind of little bit of normal maybe in the next 6 to 8 months. So in manufacturing also, what we have seen is textile dependent manufacturing sector has had a kind of a little impact from that perspective. So when we do a credit assessment, we will have to put in all these checks and balances into our credit scoring model. That's how we have been doing a new credit algo based on these different sectors and subsectors, and also based on the different geographies, because different geographies are also hit by different kind of, say for example, a metro city has been hit more compared to a semi-urban or a kind of a rural kind of a situation. We are not present in rural, but still semi-urban is not that much. And compared to Maharashtra, which is a little bit bad hit, or Mumbai is bad hit, but at the same time, say for any other city in Karnataka or in any other city in other states will have been not that much hit. So we have incorporated different algo based on the geography, based on the sector, subsector, all those things, and we have come out with a different kind of a COVID contraction score, so that we, when we apply that, then we will get to know how this this will kind of influence their credit decision. So the sector actually plays an important role, but having said that, every sector is kind of impacted. There will be different phases which it will come back to the pre-COVID normal. So we as a company also have to have a human touch also, because the sector which is badly affected actually needs more support. So that's the another thing what we are trying to tell to our customer, is that they have to be very transparent in sharing their data, whether it is good or bad, whatever has happened. They should be open to any of the NBFCs, not only with Kinara, any of the financial institutions or any of the banks, so that banks and their financial institution have an open kind of perspective towards these customers, so that we don't lose out the customers who have been actually been impacted, who actually need our support. So that's the kind of approach we are taking, so that we also balance between the business objective and also common social objectives.
Dr. Singh, you are on mute. We can't hear you.
Sorry. And I'm saying, I was just saying, Chiru, I'm great for that. And that's really, that's a real story. And, you know, basically, and that's what happening on the ground. And that's what the most of the company, it should be, you know, it should be on the top of that. And, you know, they should be taking a call from that side. which sector they belongs to, which region they belongs to, and how they're impacted. And it will be tough job. I can understand it will be tough job from a lender side,
yeah,
to evaluate that impact area and then to try to understand their payment capacity and then look at that. And that's basically things from a good credit application perspective. Let's say most of the company, forget about today, even this historically, they apply for the loan, they apply for the finance with some criteria on the application. Most of the application get rejected because some of the things are not mentioned, some of the things are not clear about the payment, which basically highlight their payment repayment capability. So according to you and how you define basically a good credit application during next normal phase or after the COVID-19 over, or when we get in the new normal phase, because I'm sure that credit application will have to be different than what it used to be pre-pandemic or during pandemic. So you think, is there any definition for that?
Yeah, see, the thing is about from a Kinara perspective, when if you have to define what is a good credit application post-COVID situation is, what we see is first we are focused on supporting our existing customers so that they come back to their business. So because that is one thing, is what advantages what we have is we have their credit history already with us, so that itself is a big thing. So we have their past track record and then how they behave with us, how their business has come down during this COVID. Because now if you ask me, like if anyone wants to see their last 6 months bank statement, then that doesn't reflect the true nature of that business. Even for a new customer, if you have to assess for the new loan, if I take their 6 months bank statement, I would not be able to assess their actual revenues or their GST returns. We cannot be able to. So one is first for the existing customers, with these data points, with their previous data set points, we will come to know that what is the impact, what is the kind of revenue contraction happen. Based on that, we will able to support. For the new customer, the thing is, we might have to get more number of bank statements rather than only the 6 months of bank statement to see their actual businesses pre-COVID. And also, we will also focus on the projection focus, because the future cash flows or the future projection is also coming an important aspect as of now, considering the situation, because we are not going to assess based on the only current situation. So this projected business plan or a projected plan is actually an important thing which any MSME should be ready with, that with the proper plan, with the proper resources, everything. So that also we have to add into our credit scoring methodology. That is one another thing we are considering. Obviously, then the normal parameters about their credit bureaus, their vintage, all those normal parameters. Definitely, the vintage will say something about the business, because it has crossed different external impact pressures. So that will also give a definite input to our credit algo. So those are all some of the good, and obviously, as I said, the sector, subsector, which has been impacted, not impacted during the COVID, all those things also we will take into consider. So we have actually kind of redefined our data science algo model, which will take into all the parameters based on different geography, sector, and everything. And then actually that will actually give us a clear view of how this businesses should be funded on a risk scale of say 1 to 10, where this business stands apart, and which are all the parameters which is of high risk, and what are the different deviations I should take in case if we have to fund this customer or support at this situation. So that's the kind of approach we are taking care. So more of digital transactions accounting with proper credit history, with the proper banking, and with with the proper kind of a repayment attitude shown during this moratorium period, all of this will help a customer to be in a good credit kind of a situation. Because just to add to that, during these last 6 months also, even from a collection perspective, we have given customers different options to pay. So earlier there was only one option to pay through say checks or whatever the payments, but during these last 6 months we have introduced Kinara into Google Pay, Phone Pay, Paytm, and like that our customer can pay through around 60-70 payment gateway app. So that is actually kind of we have fast tracked these things because of the COVID, and that is actually helping our customers to pay from their doorstep, or not even they need to go to the bank and pay. So these are all the situations which has helped the company to be more digitized, the customer to be more digitized. So that will actually help the customer to be in a very good creditable kind of a profile which any financial institutions will look forward to.
Thanks, Mr. Thiru, and I really appreciate that. And I now understand the tough job you are in, and the tough task you are facing. Normally you face a tough task. Now the post-COVID is even the tough, yeah. And I really say all the best in that phase, because you know, I just said that your job is very critical for the success of the MSME and to take them into next league. As in India, some of the World Bank statistics and some of the government, is very limited number. It's hardly 4-5% of the people are basically have access to the formal finance, and MSME I'm talking about, which means there's a need to reach out to the even the more than 90% of the people who are basically relying on their own relatives or the informal source of the finance, where basically, they go to a company, pay 36%, up to 36%, and whereas the formal finance is much, much lower. So I think you have described well in terms of putting what are the parameters required in terms of you assign loan, what are the good application look like, what is the behavioral change unique, and what are the basically services you the community or the financial communities are providing and changing. And that's basically I can understand if it's a dual approach. It's basically MSME have to also come forward, and then financial have to come in forward to ensure that both are in a win-win scenario. And statistics suggest that if formal finance is much better than the informal finance, it's basically now it's time for MSME how they can digitize and take things forward. So with that, I will basically say thanks for all our questions today. I think Noina, I think we can open floor for Q&A with our audience.
Yes, thank you Thiru, and thank you Arun for a very, very informative session. Now we are open to take audience questions. We request you to please post your question in the Q&A tab in your the Q&A tab that you can see. We will take 4-5 questions due to the time restrictions. As we are talking, and please do mention your name and your company name while you are posting the question. As we are talking, I have the first question. This is from Mr. OP Jagati. This is for Thiru. As you're talking about all the digital platforms that you are trying to empower your MSME, so Mr. Jagati is asking that, yeah. can you talk about from your interactions with MSME, are they doing anything to embrace AI in their interaction or in their business? Do you see MSMEs embracing AI?
What I understand is so we are trying to digitize our processes. That is one thing which I explained. And also we expect our customers also to be more digital, so that there is transparency in their accounting process, everything. But our sets of customers are mostly we fund 2 lakhs to say 25 lakhs kind of a customer, where their monthly turnover will be between say 50,000 to say 5 lakh or 10. I mean, that's the kind of customers. For them, getting into AI and all those things and all, that's much not kind of a relevant thing. But they are trying to do more of how do we digitize their accounting transaction, how to digitize their receivable, payable, and stuff like that. Maybe the segment is with which we are working is a little bit kind of a different. But definitely, what I've understood is other companies at a larger scale, they are trying to kind of embrace these AI also in their design process, in their customer engagement process or customer sentiment assessment process. In all those things, I think they are definitely trying to do that. Maybe Dr. Singh, you can also add any response to that question.
The next question is coming from Rupashree from PTI. She's asking, how much time do you think, Dr. Singh, for you it is, how much time do you think MSMEs will take to recover and return to the pre-pandemic earning levels? And the second part of this question is, so this is something that she wants to know, the DNB's assessment on Indian MSME and the recovery plan. So what do you think about that?
So I think, I've touched base in my presentation today. Basically, there's no single MSME plan. There's no single company recovery plan. First, we need to assess that what is the impact quantum each and every company faced. And how long that company will take. It's basically the sector alignment, sector study which we have done, which we have just recently launched last week itself. And in that, if you see, we basically looked at something around 17, 18 sectors, and the company, the recovery plan will be tagged to these sectors. So let's say, for example, you are operating within automotive space. Your recovery will be based on overall sector recovery, and hence you will recover in that space. So if I have to say in terms of impact area, I just talked about what we have looked at. We have looked at sector into the two broad categories: one, the positive impact, and one is the negative impact. The positive impact of the sectors, or maybe if you're a company operating in these sectors, like a remote working application, over the top, telecommunications, online gaming, e-education. These are the sectors, and maybe if you're operating in a digital space where the need of these digital devices or connective devices have gone up, so you don't have to worry. In fact, you are leveraging on the pandemic. The pandemic is good for that those set of company, and they are getting maximum profit. In fact, they have never seen that traction in the past, and that they're really milking the revenue. That's good for them. But there are the traditional sectors to talk about: the food, drugs, pharma, IT, ITS, media, banking, hospitality, retail, automotive, aviation, metals, textiles, powers, construction, the real estate, logistics, gems and jewelry. All these sectors are basically got impacted. The impact is basically from a moderate to high to severe. Now, and all the sectors are basically that part of that. Now, the recovery of this sector start from a 6 month to more than a year, which means when I say 6 months, starting from August or the first day of August, maybe February or March, can see some of the sectors who are retail and wholesale, livestock, power, drugs and pharma, food and food products, IT, ITS sectors. These are the companies, or these are the sectors where company belongs to, can see the pre-pandemic level of revenue growth by, let's say, February next year. Then we have a logistic and warehouse, metals, media and entertainment company, can see up to 1 year, which means maybe same time today, next year, they can see, we are almost there where we were in the February 2020. That's one thing. Now, then there are gems and jewelry, aviation, hospitality, construction, electronics, textiles, automotive, banking. If you belong to that sector, then certainly more than a year. MSME as a whole, where basically you have just 2% of the digitization rate. And this pandemic has basically created that opportunity that you increase the digitization rate, and the most of the company doing that. This company will be very fast to have a recovery, rather than the company who are basically physically dependent or dependent on the physical exercise and the manufacturing phase, where they are a victim of social distancing norms and things like that. This company will take something around 1 year to recover. So I'm there a whole recovery strategy, which sector you belongs to, and is it six months or up to 12 months or more than 12 months? That's one thing. Second, even if you are belongs to a sector that's severely impacted and recovery will take some time, but if company itself is basically well placed in terms of the good distance call, well digitized, I think their recovery period can be shortened. So it's like the three factors is playing a good role, and MSME, I think I can say safely that it will take at least 7 to 8 months for average MSME to recover. I hope that answers your question.
Arun, there's another question on the recovery and the impact also. This question is from Mr. Om Agarwal. He's trying to understand the geographical impact of COVID on rural and urban markets.
So I think this pandemic has shown the connectivity connectivity problem, or maybe then can say negated the connectivity stuff. See, Ben, I was just basically talking earlier, and when the presenting, and Ben had a conversation with Mr. Thiru, and with how, March, when the first lockdown were announced, we're saying things is going to be normal in the 20 days and things is fine. It's just restricted to some of the cities, and the problem is just the mega cities and things, things are basically going to be normal. But the lockdown was not a state, was not a district, that was basically all India, where the rural companies were also put on hold in terms of the social distancing, in terms of the guidelines, in terms of overall contribution. That happened. When subsequent unlock 2, unlock 3 happens, we have seen that unlock 2 or unlock 3 happens, we have seen the gradual withdrawal of the process. The rural industry started working where there was no pandemic, but urban industry were not working because there was a pandemic. So the impact was basically felt that it's concentration in the urban industry, not in rural, because they started. But now what you see, the Mumbai, Delhi, for example, if you see, they've recovered. There are data, reproduction data, if you see, it's close to one. It's like 1.05. It's missing reproduction in the Mumbai, Delhi. That's one of the biggest the problem area has been corrected and recovered. But now the most of the cases is going to the smaller cities, and where one can see the sporadic even coming with the lockdown stuff like that. So is everything related to the lockdown on the national level? I don't feel that one can bifurcate the impact of the urban and rural, because the pandemic has negated that connectivity issues. Everyone in India got impacted. It's just the extent of impact on the rural could be a slightly less than the urban, but it's just like, say, you're talking about 45-55 type of percentage share, which is like almost almost same. So I think this pandemic has impacted across all the company, all the sectors in a different way.
This would be the last question for today, Arun. Telemedicine's future in India is something, a question that people would like to hear from you. That what do you think about the telemedicine future in India?
So I think in one of my presentation or in one of the slide, I was just talking about that telemedicine is happening today. In fact, some of some of the section in the society within the urban space were practicing that even before pandemic, and that continued, and that got some traction because of the lockdown. People are home and not possible, so that's happening. Just see today what's happening. We're talking about more than 70% of the people are in the rural, and just 29% is urbanization rate in India. And within urban, look at digitization rate in India. Digital penetration in terms of the payment, it's a very, very good. And look at the behavioral aspects. India, the market, should also be looked at from a two perspective. One, from the base of the demand opportunity to create, and also the culture and the overall tradition, and in terms of the information base they basically have. The benefit of having a physical interaction with the hospital authority, the doctor, the pharmacy, it's they feel the far better than the conversation on the telephone or with some digital platform, or maybe ordering medicines through some app or some digital methods. Yeah, that's one thing. Today, because it's a forced on them, one can see some traction. But tomorrow, this could be an area where most of the people, 70% of the people I'm saying, 70%, they have not practiced the telemedicine, to be very honest. It's significant. They have not practiced. It's just that telemedicine has been practiced in the urban centers. Even the urban centers, there is a huge divide in terms of digitized and the not digitized. If you look at all these things, the benefit is not in terms of the, not in favor of the telemedicine area. In fact, to get into the telemedicine to success, the education, the information base has to be wide enough, and then the thinking process towards that area has to change to bring some of the tangible benefit to the telemedicine sectors, which I don't see that's going to happen in the near term, which means telemedicine sector might go back to the normal or maybe the era where February 2000 we have seen. So there, I think there's a huge opportunity, but I think there's a stakeholder coordination and collaboration required to leverage on that opportunity.
This would be the last question. Actually, this is a question which has come from Mr. Thiru. I really want to take this. This has come from Mr. Satish Kumar from Creative Sector. He would like to know that would you extend loan to service industry, and if they require it to clear off vendor dates, provided their business has picked up and if the financial track record is okay?
Yeah, yeah, 100% we fund to services also. We started with funding manufacturers and traders, but we have expanded our product to service industry also, but with different credit assessment parameters. And as Satish said, like if they have a very good track record, and if the purpose is to clear the vendor payments, then we can directly also do the payment to the vendor, and we can do that. The short answer is we do that kind of loans. Yes.
Due to paucity of time, we would not be able to answer any more questions. I would request you to please address your questions at india@dnb.com. If you write your question at india@dnb.com, we would ensure that we answer all the questions. We would also be sending a recording of this webinar to all the attendees today. Thank you so much, Arun and Thiru. And thank you so much to all the audience and the participants. Thanks so much and have a great day.
Yeah. Thank you, Noyna.
Thank you for
joining, and thank you, Noyna.
Thanks, Arun, and thanks, Noyna. Yeah.